Well, good morning, Grace Church. Happy Easter. Happy Easter. It's great to see you all this morning. Let's stand together and let's praise our risen Savior.
Power. Easter. We are so glad that you've joined us for Resurrection Sunday, where we get to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. If you are new with us, welcome. We are so glad that you've joined us this morning, and we'd love to hear from you. So we're going to have a little QR code on the screen, and it'll take you to a little survey where you can answer questions about where you've come from and who invited you or how you found out about us. Whether you were invited through a friend or you saw our website or through social media, we would love to hear from you. Easter is a big holiday. How cool is it that we have a God that didn't want to leave us in our sin and in our mess, and instead sent his one and only son, Jesus, to meet us in it and to pay the cost of sin and death so that we didn't have to, and now we can be reconciled in relationship with him. I don't know about you, but I think that's a big reason to celebrate this morning. I want to invite you all to join us next week as we kick off our brand new sermon series in the book of Revelation. It's going to be a great time, and I'm super excited to see all that God teaches us through his word as we study this book together. Thank you again for joining us this morning. We are so glad that you're here, and let's continue to worship together.
So exciting to be able to celebrate together and to sing of what Jesus has done in our lives. He came. He died for the penalty of our sins, and today we celebrate he is risen. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together and let's sing this out to him.
The wages of my sin. You knew I couldn't pay the debt. You paid it with your final breath. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. You took the wrath that I deserved. Couldn't hold you down, hell. Couldn't. steal your crown. There's resurrection power in your name, in your name. Let all the earth cry out, lift up a holy sound. Give all the glory now to Jesus' name, Jesus' name. Death couldn't hold you down. Hell couldn't steal your crown. There's resurrection power in your name, in your name. Let all the earth cry out, lift up a holy sound. Give all the glory now to Jesus' name, Jesus' name. Death couldn't hold you down. Hell couldn't steal your crown. There's resurrection power in your name, in your name. Let all the earth cry out, lift up a holy sound. Give all the glory now to Jesus' name, Jesus' name.
This morning, we just lift up your name in thanksgiving towards you for sending your son, for dying on the cross. And today we celebrate a risen Savior who has defeated sin, who has defeated death, stands victorious over everything, stands with the authority and the power over sin, over death. We thank you so much for who you are and what you've done for us and all that you continue to do. Pray all these things in the mighty, wonderful, and powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's take some time right now, turn around, and greet someone around you.
bed. Still my bed. Oh, there you go. You know, sound doesn't work. Everyone turns and looks at that poor guy in the back. Well, yeah, it was my bad. Hey, welcome. Good to see you all. Happy Easter and Resurrection Day. He is risen. He's risen indeed. Absolutely. Well, it's great to have you all here. Welcome, and what a great morning we've already had. We had earlier service, and the snow is beautiful from in here, isn't it? Just get to look and enjoy that beauty. I'm thankful the Lord seems to have given us more snow days this year as we've been in our new place with these windows, but I'm glad you're here. We are here. If you're a guest, man, we're really glad you found us. Glad to have you as a part of our celebration. We are, without apology, talking about the resurrection of Jesus, and it is a big deal. That's why the church meets every week, but especially on this particular calendar day, we're here with great confidence and joy and changed lives to look to God and say thank you for what He's done for us. But we're here because it follows, really, a pretty rough Friday, pretty terrible, horrible, challenging, yet spectacular day when Jesus went to a cross. And so we're not here without stopping and thinking about that Friday. This morning I'm going to talk about the cross made the difference. And that is it. That's the difference. That's what we're all about. That's what puts us in this room. That's what makes us who we are, is because there's a cross. And it's a real thing. It really happened. And so for this last Friday, we gathered, had a good full room as we contemplated the cross and the meaning of the cross, specifically why did Jesus have to die? Why did He pay a penalty for me? And so we discussed that Friday night. And so this morning, as we're here thinking about this new morning and the resurrection of Jesus, what it means for us. Perhaps you saw as you came in, I don't know, we have a new rock out there. We got some beautiful landscaping the last couple of weeks. If you're new to Grace, we're brand new in this building. This is our third month in here. And so because it was winter time, they're getting the landscaping done, which I know you haven't seen a lot of it because it keeps snowing on Sundays. But there's some really cool landscaping, and they've done a great job. But part of the capstone of that is there's this really nice rock as you walk in there at the front porch. And it's Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. So I appreciate Tom Gosh and putting that together for us. But that verse is kind of why we're here when we think about we have been saved by grace through faith. This is not our own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that we, that no one may boast. And that's what it's all about. By faith, we're saved by God's kindness. So the cross. Let's just take a moment. Let me review the highlights. We're going to get to the glorious resurrection in just a second. But Friday's cross, again, you don't get here without stopping and realizing that this all costs something. We're not here because of our merit. We're not here because we just like this kind of vibe. We're here because of a cross. It made all the difference. A couple passages. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, Scripture says, "For our sake," that's us, "for our sake, He made Him," God made Jesus, "to be sin, who knew no sin." As you know, Jesus was perfect, flawless, born among men, lived among us, did life alongside of us, engaged with the same challenges we all engage with, yet without sin. So He knew no sin, so that in Him we, Paul says to the church, and I would say to us, those that know Christ, that we might become the righteousness of God. Not just that we would have a better life or that things would be nice or we'd find a nice little lane to get through life in a pretty well way, but no, that we would actually become the righteousness of God. That's what Christ did for us on the cross. In a while, we're going to look at 1 Corinthians 15. Later in that passage, it says in verse 21, "For as by a man came death," and that talks about Adam, as you remember, our father Adam is one who got us in this mess when he sinned against God in the garden. "For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead." So Adam comes and gets us in a mess. Jesus comes to fix that mess. And because He rose from the dead, which today is all about, now He has kicked death in the teeth. And He's more victorious and powerful than death. And so the Scripture says, "For as Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive." So that's why this is such a big deal. So the cross that we came to this last week and Jesus had come to accomplish, pretty significant part of the story. If you would let me just, I want to read some verses for you. I'm going to read it in a fashion. I'm just going to throw these verses. I'm not going to give you references. I'm not going to have you look them up. Just listen. Just let this wash over you as you think about and contemplate what Jesus did for us and what it cost him. So let me just read some of these for you. This will be brief. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. In Colossians 2:14, by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands, this he set aside, nailing it to the cross. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. So there you go. There's a real quick look at why the cross, why Jesus shed his blood. It was the perfect blood of Jesus that covers our sin, my sin, your sin, so that when God sees us by faith, in the grace of God, he sees the blood of Christ. That sin is paid for. On the cross, they would nail on the very top of the cross a little placard that would say the criminal's crime. As you'll remember, both sides of Jesus were thieves, robbers, they called them. So above their head would be thief, robber. Above Jesus, they put King of the Jews. They didn't know what to say because they didn't understand why he was dying. But what we know is that above Jesus was my sin. My sin was nailed to the cross. He went to the cross for Mark and for you without the Friday. And so now that we come to Sunday, we get to talk about the resurrection. So we have an empty cross, which we celebrate and thank God that he's not there. But now we have an empty tomb. The resurrection, Sunday's resurrection, what brings you and me here today is to celebrate. And for some of you, perhaps it's not yet a celebration. It might be more of an introduction. What's the big deal with Easter? You got to think, if there's an empty cross and an empty tomb, I would do well to ask, so why? What does that mean for me? Well, we want to help you with that. So I want to read for you the account of what took place on that Sunday morning. As I mentioned, every Sunday we gather because of that, but there's something special about this particular calendar day. So Matthew 28, 1 through 11, if you would do me the favor of standing in honor of God's word as I read this passage for us. You can follow along, and you might know the story, but I think we would do well to remind ourselves and to actually read the text. Matthew 28, 1 through 11. Now, after the Sabbath, which was Saturday, toward the dawn of the first day, which, of course, is Sunday morning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. Wouldn't that be a cool job to have if you're an angel? It's like, there's a lot of things angels do, but to be the one that God said, I need you to go do this thing for me, that'd be awesome, right? His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. These are Roman guards. These are dudes. And they fall apart. They fall to the ground as dead. But the angel said to the women, who, by the way, apparently didn't fall to the ground, said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen. And he said, 'Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he's going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I've told you.' So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, 'Greetings.' And they came and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. While they were going, behold, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests all that had taken place. God, we're here with your word open before us, just in awe of this day that we get to look back and remember that first resurrection day, but also to celebrate what it means for us and to invite our friends and family and guests to know the meaning of this and what it can mean for them. So we ask your blessing in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, this is awesome, isn't it? I mean, there's this real event that happened. There's a real cross where Jesus suffered and died. They took him down from the cross and they put him in a tomb, a borrowed tomb, of course, short-term lease, someone told me this morning, on this tomb. And then Sunday morning, he's not there. He's risen. The resurrection is awesome. Matthew 28:6 says it so well. Read this out loud with me. Here we go. He is not here. So there's a place today in Israel. There's actually a couple places that they're pretty clear. One of those is the place where the body had been. I've had the privilege to go to Israel a couple times. Some of you have come along. We hope to go again next year when things settle down. But when you go to Israel, you can go to both of these places, and you can go inside. I think I have a picture of, this is called the Garden Tomb. This is one of the popular places where they believe the actual tomb of Jesus would have been. So when you come to the Garden Tomb, next shot here is, look at her. Yeah, isn't she a hottie? So that's the tomb, and we're smiling. Why are we smiling? Well, because that's us, but because the tomb is empty. So the next shot, you see the tomb, this whole garden area. Back behind you on this side is like a garden with some trees. And so when we take a group there, after we walk through there, we'll go off to the side. It's so precious. And we'll have communion together. And we'll remember the cross, that it was a real thing. This is a real person who really died for us. And they put him in there. And then they came, and he wasn't there. The other site that might be popular, I don't have a picture of it for you this morning, but the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, we've seen that as well. I've not gone inside. It's like right in the middle of stuff, super busy. A high possibility that could have been it as well. But let me just tell you, both places are empty, all right? The tomb is empty. That is so awesome. That's why we're here today. So the cross and the empty tomb, you have a hard Friday we call good because we have something because of it. And then you have this powerful resurrection morning that we're here to celebrate. Both of this, the cross and the empty tomb, lead us to today's gospel. The very gospel that we tell about. Today's gospel is in 2 Corinthians 6:2. It's an old, old story. For 2,000 years, this gospel has been clear. This gospel has been talked about. It's been spread. Bazillions of people around the globe have encountered this gospel and it's changed their lives. There's hundreds of people in Flagstaff, thousands of people that have heard this gospel and it's changed their lives. So it's old, but yet today is something. 2 Corinthians 6:2, for he says, in a favorable time, quoting from Isaiah, I listened to you, and in a day of salvation I have helped you. And then Paul says, behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. So there was a time when they were looking forward to Messiah coming. There would be a Jesus, there would be a Christ, there would be a death. And now we're looking back saying, wow, it happened. And that's what Paul's saying. Today is the day of salvation. We're no longer looking ahead saying, man, I hope he comes and does something. He came and did it. So today's gospel. Because of the empty cross and the empty tomb, I want us to look in 1 Corinthians 15. We're going to take a few moments. The whole chapter is on resurrection. It's a pretty powerful and long chapter. We're just going to look at the first few verses to help us understand what this Resurrection Sunday can mean and do for us. So 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 1 says, Paul is writing to a church, a group of Christians in Corinth. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. So before we move on from these first couple of verses, whether you're kind of new to the Christian community or you've been at this for a long time, one of the key things in reading the Bible, in Bible study, when you open a passage, and I know it can be intimidating, there's a lot of stuff and a lot of questions and I don't understand it all. When you open it, one of the very first things you learn to do is to make observation. What is it saying? Before you try to figure out what does it mean and all the stuff that we've been talking about and arguing about for centuries and people write about and commentators and church fathers, all that has a place. But you start with the most basic. Well, what is it saying? And so when you look at these two verses, right away you could do that exercise of observation. What is he saying? So if we go back to verse number one, you'll see where it says, I would remind you, so Paul has already told them something. I'm reminding you, brothers, people that are in the faith together, of the gospel. And so he's going to talk about the gospel. I'm reminding you of this gospel. But notice what he says, I preached it to you. That's past tense. He's like, you guys remember that time I preached the gospel to you? I'm reminding you of that. Clear observation. I preached to you, which you received. So the observation was Paul preached the gospel to them at some point, and they, what? Received it. Like they heard it, believed it, they took it. And he says, in which you stand. That's present tense. So past, I preached, you received. Present tense is now you're standing in that. That's like a statement of faith. That's your declaration. I believe the gospel, and the gospel put me here. And the next verse, he says, and by which you are being saved. In other words, I'm living this out. What he did for me, eternally secure now. I know Christ died for me. I've received it. I'm his child. When I die, I go to heaven. I know that truth, but now I'm living it out. That's what it means by being saved. You're living as a result of that. But then he also says, if you hold fast the word that I preached, unless you believe. So if you were to make a list of your observations, what is Paul saying about the gospel in these first two verses, just to kick you off? Number one, I gave it to you, it's the gospel. We're going to look in just a moment at what we mean by gospel. So here's what Paul says about it, and there's a list for you. Number one, gospel. Secondly, preached. So gospel, Paul gave them, he preached it to them. And that just means proclaim. Preach doesn't mean you have to get on a stage with a podium and get all dressed up. Preaching just means you get to proclaim, you get to tell the good news. Preaching happens sometimes at a place like this. Sometimes preaching happens in the break room at work. Sometimes preaching happens when you turn on the radio. Sometimes preaching happens over the back fence, proclaiming what God has done. Notice he also says received. So I preached it and you received it. Received means they got it. It's like, yes, I'll take what you're saying. I believe that. To be standing in it, as I mentioned, says, this is who I am. It's my declaration. He did that for me, and they receive it. And they stand in that, but then they continue to live it out. So the clear observation from these first couple verses is there is good news to be proclaimed. And you are to receive that. The Corinthians understood enough to receive it as truth. And then we stand in it as a way of life, confident, not cocky, not prideful, humble, that God would do that for me. And are being saved. This is the good news of living it out, telling others, just living in the Word, knowing that Christ has done something for me. So when you look at those first two verses, you make your list of what it's about, it really comes down to a really key thing that we're going to take a few minutes on, and that is, what is the gospel? If he says, I'm reviewing, remember that time I preached the gospel to you. Now we want to articulate, so what's the gospel? And all of us need to know that. Many of you do. We need to be able to articulate and to say to somebody, here's what the gospel is. And so let's take a moment. In verse number 3, Paul begins to describe it for us. He says, for I delivered to you as of first importance, and gospel is good news, so he's going to lay it out for us, what I also received. So I gave you what I received. And there's something to that about the gospel. I received it, and now he's given it to them. Notice how he describes it. That Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scripture. So in other words, there really is a Jesus, and there really was a cross. The Bible told us it would happen, and then the Bible tells us that it did happen and how it happened. And then next, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, again, in accordance with the Scriptures. So there really was a cross, and there really was a tomb. They buried him in there. There were witnesses to that. And then he rose again on the third day. The scriptures told us it would happen. And then the scriptures told us how it happened. Then, he says, and that he then appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. He appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom were still alive at the writing of this. Though some had fallen asleep, passed away. Then he appeared to James and the apostles. Last of all, Paul says, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. And so you have the good news defined for us. Don't mess with this. You want to know what the good news is. Don't get this wrong. The good news isn't being a good person. Everybody say amen to that, right? The good news isn't based on how well you're doing, how much you give to help people, or all that stuff that's nice. The good news is this, and he lays it out for us. Number one, Christ died for sin according to the scripture. You have it there on the screen. The good news is, number one, say it for me. That's the gospel. Christ died for sin. The verses I read under the part about the cross is he actually became sin for me. His blood, perfect. He's the Son of God, covers my sin, so God sees that. He died for my sin. Number two, the gospel is that Christ rose, defeating death. Again, according to the scripture. This wasn't a mystery. This was clearly testified to and accounted for. So he rose, defeating death. We just read the passages about it. The scripture is full of it. So number one, the gospel is, say it. And number two, you guys just proclaimed the gospel. Good job. You're a bunch of evangelists. That's what the gospel is, to be real clear. And then number three, he says that he appeared, making witnesses to go and tell. So he didn't just rise from the dead, and then there's this mystery secret club that kind of knows about it and kind of doesn't know about it, and we're not really showing anybody this tomb just in case. No, he appeared in front of witnesses, and he gives us a whole bunch of them. Clearly, over 500 people saw Jesus in those 50 days before the ascension. So he was testified by witnesses. I love this. The gospel is very clear. Christ appeared so that witnesses could go and tell. So the gospel is made very clear to us. But what I like about what Paul does in this passage is then he kind of relates to me and maybe to you when he says in verse number 9, he talks about, I'm not worthy. Like, I'm not worthy of this. And before we dig into this, I just want you to know you're in good company this morning because you're with a bunch of people, matter of fact, all of us, that aren't worthy of what Christ did for us. You don't become worthy, whether it's by your background or your good works or your how you think. No, we're all unworthy. We're all guilty. As the Bible said, we have sin that separates us from God. Paul was the same way. And so he acknowledges that in verse number 9. He said, "For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God." My guess is there's not a lot of people in the room here that have been like getting after it, persecuting the church. Perhaps that's you. I don't know. You may not be that angry against the church. Paul, before he was converted, was called Saul, and he was a lead persecutor. And the reason he did so, going after Christians, he thought he was honoring the God of the Pharisees and this false religion of good works and deeds and high moral rules that guided them, all the while missing who Jesus is. And so Paul was fired up about that. So he would like go to Christians and stop them and haul them off to be arrested and judged, and some even to their death. So he now says, man, my life changed. I was unworthy. I was the guy that was hateful and angry and bitter and aggressive towards Christianity. So whether you identify today as one who's been hostile towards Jesus or the church or the Christian faith, or some particular doctrine, whatever it is, just know you're in good company. Whether you were angry or you're just kind of complacent, none of us have been worthy on our own. As Paul said in Romans, we're actually called guilty. I'm guilty. My sin put Jesus on the cross, as did yours. So Paul says, I was unworthy. His life changed because of that. And his life changed in a dramatic way, and it was demonstrated as he told others, including these Corinthians, I've declared this to you and you've received it. So before we get too wound up on how unworthy we are, I want you to hear what the gospel says. The gospel of grace says differently. The gospel of grace comes to you, comes to me in my unworthiness. Grace says it differently. As I mentioned, it's all about the cross. The cross changes everything. The cross is what clarifies who we are. Again, that verse I mentioned earlier that we have out on the front. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. For by grace you've been saved through faith. Not by works, not by religion, not by good deeds. None of us have enough of those. I appreciate you trying. I appreciate the fact that we mean well. But Paul says we're unworthy. We don't have enough. It's only by his grace that changes us. We've been saved. Not a result of works, so that we, no one, may boast. So what do you do with this? Well, this is a gift. The gospel is a gift. The gospel of grace is God saying to you, I love you. I see you in your unworthiness. And by the way, there are thousands of people among us, around us, all throughout our community, around the world, that have yet to hear this and understand it. So there's a lot of people. And I praise God they're willing to come to a church like this or watch online and kind of lean in and listen. Because I'm telling you, when you see an empty cross and an empty tomb, you probably ought to ask what's going on, because something powerful is happening. Jesus Christ took my place on the cross, died for my sin, rose again victorious over death so that I can now be saved. I can be born again. So what do you do with this? Well, it's a gift. What do you do with a gift? You receive it. You receive the gift. I told the early crowd, someone gave me a gift this morning, and it was hot, and it had icing on it. And guess what I did? I received it. I don't normally eat stuff on Sunday morning, but I gobbled that thing down before I could pray. And it's like, God, thank you for that later. Receive the gift. What Jesus has done for us, you can talk and argue and ask questions. Please ask questions. Please understand, but please know that God gives you this gift by grace through faith. So thank him for it. The applications this morning are simple. Number one, receive the good news. If you have yet to receive the good news and know in your heart that you have been born again, I'm talking separate from trying to be worthy. I'm talking separate by trying to say, I don't need the blood of Jesus. I can figure this out on my own. No. When you realize who Jesus is and what he's done for you, receive the good news. We can help you afterwards. After the close of the service, we'll have another song in a moment. There'll be some people up here afterwards to pray with you, to answer questions, to help you understand this. It is like the biggest thing to us. That's why we're here. It's to let people know God loves them. As Paul proclaimed the gospel and they received it, today, 2,000 years later, we're still proclaiming that same good news so that you'll receive it. So your applications, receive it. Number two, thank God for the empty cross and the empty tomb. Many of you have already come to faith in Christ. You know you're born again. You know you're God's child. And we're here today as a church to celebrate the empty cross and the empty tomb, to not ever get tired of talking about it and singing our songs of praise about it. The blood of Jesus paid the price so that I can know him. Praise him for it. Celebrate. Have fun. And then number three, help someone this week somehow know the goodness of God. Find a way to proclaim it. Chances are it won't be a pulpit with a Bible open and a suit and tie. It might just be an opportunity to say, hey, how you doing? How can I pray for you? And crack open the door. Share with someone this week the goodness of God. Let me pray for us. God, we thank you. We thank you that the difference is found in the cross. It's not found in religion or finding your way to a particular type of church, Lord. It's in who you are and what you've done for us. And so, Lord, this morning we hear your gospel once again. We love Resurrection Sunday. We love the Easter holiday, a chance to just celebrate and look to that empty tomb and that empty cross and know that you are alive and that what you did so that we can know you. And Lord, we invite our friends and our family, our guests, to know the same. Father, receive our worship as a praise. Thank you for what you're doing amongst us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together as we continue to thank Jesus together.
I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glory. Thank you.
What a powerful song to end on. Amen. We want to invite you, if you've not yet had that blood applied to you, we want to invite you to know for sure what Christ has done for you as a gift, and you just need to receive it. So as I mentioned, there'll be some people up here in just a moment as we're dismissed in a little bit to talk with you. Please don't be shy. Don't miss this opportunity. I'm so glad you guys came out on this snowy Easter morning, right? I mean, who else gets to look out at this beautiful scenery on Easter Sunday, right? Probably not in Jerusalem, but here we are enjoying it. So glad you guys have all been a part of this morning. We do have some treats for you. If you're into that, we've got some nice stuff for you in the back, some donuts and coffee. So make yourself at home and visit a little bit, get to know some people, welcome them, and then we'll have another service in a little bit. So God bless you. Have a wonderful rest of your resurrection day. Amen.